was asleep in his car. So two ways he demonstrated great faith. And so the water became, when he rebuked the wind and the waves, the water became as calm as he was. He was so calm, he just fell asleep in the boat. And then he calmed also the water and the wind. And so we see here that he had power over weather patterns. Mm-hmm. Storms, which I want us to know that just about every single thing we face in this world comes as a result of sin. That when Adam sinned and sin entered the world, almost every single problem can be traced to sin.
That's right.
Okay? When sin entered the world, everything was disturbed. Did you know that? Everything was kind of stirred up and torn up. So because of Adam's sin, all these things now in the atmosphere, all the hurricanes, all the, guys, we can trace everything back.
That's right.
So what did you see that Jesus has power over? What does he have power over? Mm-hmm. All the things that hurt mankind because of sin.
That's right.
Because of the devil. He has power. How many know he has power over the devil?
Amen.
And so the disciples couldn't figure Jesus out. Says they were amazed and asked, what kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. So they already knew he had divine power. Let's look at Matthew 4, verses 23 through 25. It says that Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness among the people. News about him spread all over Syria, and the people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain, the demon possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them. And so we know that they already knew that he had divine power, but now they realize he has divine power over the elements, over the weather patterns. But I think there's a little bit more here. I think that they are trying to figure out how to grasp how this man, here is a man, he looks just like you, he looks just like me, human, how he operates in divine power. Where exactly does this power, because he called him a man, and said, what kind of man is this? That's going to be important. So just keep that in you a minute, okay? But how many know that all of these works of darkness that Jesus has power over? All the weather patterns. It says he came preaching. Chapter 4, it says he came preaching the good news. Why? Because of sin. Yeah. Because everybody was a sinner. Yeah. So he came, first of all, preaching the good news. So every single thing he did, he was overcoming a work of Satan.
That's right.
So chapter 4, he overcame disease. He overcame demon possession. So everything that the enemy had to do with, he overcame it.
Amen.
Amen. So now, I want you to know that I've already taught this, but I want us to go back to this. That Jesus was not operating in divine power as the Son or second person of the Trinity, but as a man accessing the power of the Holy Spirit. You know, you've probably already heard that before. But Jesus chose not to operate out of his power as the Son of God. What does that do for us? What does that tell us? When Jesus was on earth doing all these things, but he did not operate out of his own divinity, but rather that he operated out of the very same power that we operate out of.
Hmm. Amen.
And he operated out of the power of the Holy Spirit.
Praise God.
That was given to him at his baptism.
Amen.
How many think they see just a little bit of the picture?
Yes.
It's going to come together.
Yes.
one of these days. Amen?
Amen.
Now, I can give you three scriptures. I'm not going to go to them, but I'll tell you where you find out that Jesus did not operate out of his own power on earth as the Son of God. And scriptures are Philippians 2, John 3, and John 14, and I can give you probably five more. But we'll come to those later. Okay, so that's not me making this up.
Amen.
Okay, so I want us to notice that there were other people who were not of little faith at the same time the disciples. Jesus said, look at verse 8, verse 26. He said, you of little faith. Why are you so afraid? Now let's go to 8:5, and we're going to see somebody who was not a Jew and was not one of his disciples who had great faith.
Amen.
Okay?
Wow.
How many want to have great faith?
Amen.
How many want to operate in great faith?
Amen.
How many know that there's a lot of evil?
Yes.
There's a lot of stuff that the devil has done, is doing, that Jesus had power over, and he gives his people power over.
Amen.
Amen? So said chapter 8, verse 5 of Matthew, when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a servant came to him asking for help. Lord, he said, my servant lies at home paralyzed and in terrible suffering. Jesus said to him, I will go and heal him. The centurion replied, Lord, I do not deserve to have you come under my roof, but just say the word and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes, and that one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it. And when Jesus heard this, he was astonished and said to those following him, I tell you the truth. I have not found anyone in Israel with such great faith.
Praise God.
I say to you that many will come from the east and the west and will take their places at the feast with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown out into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go, it will be done just as you believed it would. And his servant was healed at that very hour.
Praise God.
Guys, it's saying there that we have to have faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please him.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
So here's one that pleased him, and he's saying that all of these that don't have faith, they will have weeping and gnashing of teeth. So what I'm talking about isn't really optional.
That's right.
We have to go forward in faith. We got to take this kingdom for him. Amen? Really quiet.
Amen.
Amen means I agree. So be it.
Amen.
Amen. I know you're trying to process, but when you respond like that and say, yes, amen, amen, that helps your faith to take hold, okay?
Amen.
So let's get pretty loud in our amens.
Yes.
Okay, we got to pick up all the people that aren't here tonight. Okay. So you got to say amen for three or four tonight.
Amen.
All right. Okay. I'm sure glad Charles showed up. So think about
amen.
It. Think about this. Chapter 8, verse 23, where we were about the storm. If the disciples had adequate faith, they could have rebuked the storm.
Amen. Yeah.
They
wow.
could have stood up while he was sleeping.
Yeah.
And
that's right.
said the same thing he did. I rebuke you, winds and waves.
Hmm.
He said their problem wasn't that they the danger they were in. The problem is they didn't have enough faith to
wow.
do what they needed to do in the storm.
Amen. Wow.
You know, John Wesley was in a storm going from the United States to England, and there were some people there that were not afraid. Forget what they were, the Moravians. He was absolutely petrified in this storm. because these people, Moravians from a place, a part of Germany, they were just singing at the top of their lungs while the storm was going on. And they were just testifying and praising God. And he said he realized he wasn't even saved.
Wow.
He had no faith. And he went back home and he got saved.
All right.
And he got saved right there.
Praise God.
But,
wow.
Amen.
Amen.
So what kind of a man, they said, what kind of a man is this? And I want to say, he's a man like us. Jesus was a man like us. But he operated in great faith.
Amen. Amen.
He operated in greater faith than the disciples did. Now, we were traveling to Florida around 2009, and the radio kept coming with an announcement in the weather that as we were coming into Florida, that there was going to be terrible weather pattern that was going to be stuck for about 10 days. It was the whole time we were going to be there in Orlando. And it was going to be hot, and it wasn't going to be one little shower on one day. They normally in Orlando have a shower every day. In the afternoon, it kind of cools things down. But there wasn't going to be a single shower. So there was just this weather pattern that was stuck. And it was going to affect 25 to 50,000 of our own delegates for our General Assembly. And there was people coming from all over the world. As we were driving there, these people were flying in from all over the world. And all of a sudden, I rolled the window down, and I looked up at the sky, and what did I say, Charles? You were there. What did I say? Okay, I said, I rebuke you, weather pattern.
That's what I thought.
I just looked at the sky and I just said, I rebuke you, weather pattern.
That's right, that's right.
And then I rolled my window back down and we went on. And it rained every day. And he told everybody, it's my wife that brought this rain.
Yeah, she prayed it in.
He felt there was such authority in my voice. He said, do they know you did this? when Trump got elected, he said, do they know you did this? He said, we're going to the inauguration because you prayed in Trump. I said, I have no desire to go to the inauguration. So, you see what I'm saying? How many know we got to have some faith?
Amen.
It was cool every day, guys. It rained a little bit in every afternoon. The weather was comfortable. That whole weather pattern moved.
Amen.
Whoa! I wish I had that faith every day. You know? Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. And you know, about that same time, sometime that year, Randy got really sick. She had an obstruction in her small intestine. And they were going to take her on a Sunday morning at 5 a.m. for a surgery. And the surgery was very dangerous. I won't go into all that. I just have to say that night I prayed. Well, about 12 o'clock that night, I sent a text to every one of our disciples that I had a number for. And I said in the text, Randy will not have the surgery. The obstruction will be gone by the time the doctor comes to take her to surgery. And it was exactly like that.
Wow. Yeah.
She was dismissed on the day she was supposed to have a horrible surgery.
That's right. Amen.
Wow.
Yes. Amen. It was gone.
Now, see, it's not me saying we need faith, it's him,
that's
isn't
right.
it?
That's right.
He said there's no faith in Israel. He said these people are going to be thrown out. It's terrible not to have faith, isn't it?
That's right.
And faith needs to impact every area of our life.
Yes.
Every part of our life, we live by faith.
That's right.
We operate by faith. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. How many are with
amen.
Me? Amen. How many praying for me?
Amen, yes. Lead us.
Double and triple amens?
Amen, amen, amen. Amen.
Praise God.
God is good.
Praise God. How many know that God wants to do mighty things through us?
Yes, he does.
Through his people.
Praise him.
Praise God. Brandy could be dead.
Yeah.
Somebody have faith. Probably.
Praise God.
Amen. But I got an answer way ahead. And I sent out a text and I said, she's not having that surgery. I said, that obstruction's gone.
Praise God.
It was 5 o'clock. They,
yes.
They did an answer,
yes.
And gone.
Yes.
5 o'clock in the morning.
That's right.
Do you think it's kind of exciting to live by faith?
Amen. Amen.
It's kind of exciting, isn't it? Yes. Okay, now one more. Well, this is the middle scripture. And it's Matthew 17.
Amen.
Because you got a little bit more, see the picture a little bit clearer. So we're going to Matthew 17, verse 14. And then be ready to go to Mark 9. And then we'll finish with John 14. I'm sorry, there's three more scriptures. John 14. So here we have the healing of the boy with the demon. When they came to the crowd, how many are there? Matthew 17:14. Mm-hmm. Yes. When they came to the crowd, a man approached Jesus and knelt before him. Lord, have mercy on my son, he said. He has seizures and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they could not heal him. Mm-hmm. Oh, unbelieving and perverse generation. Jesus replied, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy here to me. Jesus rebuked the demon and it came out of the boy and he was healed from that moment. Then the disciples came to Jesus in private and asked, why couldn't we drive it out? He replied, because you have so little faith. I tell you the truth, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. So we're going to look at this for a minute. So they're caught in this situation. And what we don't understand, unless we go to Mark 9, because it's not all in, we'll have to hold both Matthew 17 and Mark 9. There were all these scribes and there were these Jewish rulers and leaders and all these people that were making fun of the disciples and basically making fun of Jesus. We can see that 9:14. They saw a large crowd around them and the teachers of the law arguing with the disciples when Jesus and the three disciples came down from the Mount of Transfiguration. As soon as all the people saw Jesus, they were overwhelmed with wonder and ran to greet him. What are you arguing with them about? He asked. And so here it was all these Jewish ruler people arguing with the disciples. And when he asked, what are they arguing about? A man in the crowd answered, teacher, I brought you my son, who's possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not. Oh, unbelieving generation, Jesus replied, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me. So they brought him, and when the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into a convulsion. Something was about to happen in the presence of Jesus. He fell to the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. And Jesus asked the boy's father, how long has he been like this? From childhood, he answered. It has often thrown him into the fire or water to kill him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. If you can, said Jesus, everything is possible for him who believes.
Amen.
Immediately, the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. And when Jesus saw that a crowd was running to the scene, he rebuked the evil spirit. Amen. You deaf and mute spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. Amen. And what we read in chapter 17, it says he rebuked the spirit, the demon. And so these are just two different perspectives of the same story. And so the spirit shrieked, convulsed him violently, and came out. The boy looked so much like a corpse that many said he's dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him to his feet, and he stood up. After Jesus had gone indoors, his disciples asked him privately, "Why couldn't we drive it out?" He replied, "This kind can come out only by prayer." So on the other story, it said that it could only come out by what? By what? Faith. And here he says by prayer. And we know that there's a little bit of authority that it's prayer and fasting. There's one source. So let me go over this real quick now. The disciples are caught in a situation that casts a bad light on them and Jesus, because there's this person that they can't heal. And so they are, these scribes and people are in a sense putting Jesus down and saying, well, he's not really who he says he is or whatever. And so there's this situation of a suffering young man that's terrible, isn't he? In terrible trouble. The spirit just throws him around and just tortures him. And so here they are, this child, this person with this need, this overwhelming need. There's a distraught father. There is a jeering crowd of cruel Jews. And here are these disciples that are humiliated. And the father has more faith than they do. Jesus asked, it's up to you. If you have faith, he will be healed. And the man said what?
I believe. Help me overcome my unbelief.
Yes. He said, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. So Jesus said to him, if you can. See, the disciples couldn't. And so somebody had to have faith. For Jesus to operate, there had to be faith. That's what I read in the Bible. What about y'all? It said in Nazareth he couldn't do any miracles because they had no belief. They had unbelief. So the father has all this faith. And one place it says that they lacked faith. One place it said they need to pray. And what do you think that they needed prayer for? So they would have faith. This comes about by prayer.
Amen.
If any of you lack faith, ask to God. James.
Amen.
That's right.
And he will give to you liberally.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
Praise God. Amen. How many say the picture's getting a little bit clearer, but sorry, we have a pastor that takes a while to get it.
No, it's good.
Picture drawn. I don't think we learn if we learn too fast. I think God is good because he knows that we learn step by step.
Amen.
Amen. So Jesus said, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock. And the door. So with anything, it comes through prayer. All the things that we need come through prayer, right? And that's why he said, ask and you shall receive. And those very words are to engender faith in us. Right? If he says, ask and we will receive, what should we believe? We should believe that we will receive, right?
Amen.
He says, seek and you will find. Should we believe we shall find? Did I find the book today that I needed?
Woo-hoo.
Was it
Amen.
Given to me in a random, crazy way? And I just happened to have a backpack on my back.
Praise God.
That I could carry all those books. And I just happened to feel the Holy Spirit say to me, look at those books. And I looked through them and there was none that I knew. I knew none of them, but I looked at this one. Oh, that's exactly what I mean. Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen.
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 Now, I'm at conclusion now. How many say, okay, I'm glad you got through, Pastor. I know Roy got really upset last week telling me how long it went. No, 2 weeks ago. Is that okay for me to say that, Roy? He said, what happened? happened is that he went home and something happened, kept him out until 12 o'clock at night, but it wasn't me. It wasn't church. Amen. So, but what I want us to notice there, what does he say about them that they can't help this man? What does he say in both places, both Matthew and Mark? Shocking words. Look at it. What does he say? Little faith. Okay, he says even worse than that. Look at chapter 9:19 and look at chapter 17 of Matthew, verse 17. We got to understand why he says to them, do you know where we are, Jerome? And Mark 9. Mark 9 and Matthew 7. What's that? 17. Yes, that's easy to remember. What does he say?
Oh, unbelieving, perverse generation.
Unbelieving and perverse generation.
Wow.
How long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up? Wow. I want you to think about, I want you to read that through about three times while I'm coughing.